Hi, I'm your host, Rebecca James, and I'm coming to you from the premiere of Dr. Brian Boxer Walkler's documentary, Behind the Lens, featuring the insertable contact lens procedure, and I've got the doctor himself here with me now. So tell us, what made you want to make the documentary?
Well, I think that for most people who haven't been involved in the broadcast news side of media, this is a really fascinating pull the curtain back view of what goes on, because there's a lot of really interesting, surprising elements that went into the shoot that the Today Show did. But just on top of the standard stuff that's behind the scenes, there were some really like unbelievable things that happened, which I look back and said, I just have to tell this story to people, because when I talked to people, they said, no way, there's no way that occurred. And it did, and that's why I'm telling the story.
I've got one of his patients here with me now. His name's Dave, and Dave's going to tell us a little bit about the procedure that he had done.
Yes, hi. My name is Dave, and I had the procedure done 1 week ago yesterday, last Friday. It's a godsend. I'm really excited about the prognosis and the potential for seeing well once again, much like when I was a teenager. So that'll be good. I also have a keratoconus and advanced astigmatism, so this is really going to be a great thing for me, and it's a wonderful procedure.
We always like to do these fun things for our patients. They're kind of like our family. And so my motto has always been, if you don't have fun doing it, why do it? So even though I'm a physician and I take care of people and fix their vision, we like to have fun with our patients and our friends along the way too. So it's more than just what goes on in the office, the way our practice is.
It was earlier than I usually operate. I was performing a new procedure called the Visian ICL, which are maintenance-free contact lens implants to correct vision. You can't feel them, just like you can't feel a dental filling. Everything was going smoothly until I started hearing voices. It sounded really familiar. It was comedian Steve Carell. What's he doing in my ear? As you can imagine, this was kind of disturbing. I'm trying to do eye surgery listening to all this. Where is this coming from? I asked myself, what is going on? And how did I ever get here? Tuesday, March 4th, 2008 was a special day for a lot of people. On that morning, NBC's Today Show aired me performing live Visian ICL contact lens implants to correct sports journalist Alan Abrahamson's nearsightedness in front of millions of viewers. Alan wasn't a good candidate for LASIK because of his thin corneas, like keratoconus, nor was he really comfortable with the LASIK procedure. Right after the show aired, something happened that no one expected. Not me, not the show's producers, not anyone. Without warning, a tsunami of interest was released and hit all of us simultaneously. Our phone lines lit up like the Christmas tree in Rockefeller Center. We suddenly had over 500 emails, and calls flooded our office. Our staff had to work overtime just to keep up with it all. I had colleagues of mine across the country tell me they were getting calls about this Visian ICL, even ophthalmologists in the remotest parts of the country. The Today Show website had so many hits, I heard it almost shut down. In fact, there were so many people who watched the video segment on the Today Show website, the producers did something they never do. They aired a follow-up piece 3 days later.
No irritation worth mentioning. In fact, he saw the alarm clock, you know, that next morning. He was so thrilled to read that. So, and as he mentioned, the show, his first stop was to the DMV, where they put him to the test, reading three lines off the eye chart.
This live surgery coverage fascinated a country of viewers and captured the imagination of millions of people unlike anything I'd ever witnessed before.
Well, right now I'm actually in the process of inserting the lens.
It was clear to me this segment struck a deep, deep chord out there.
It's a little bit like
during the first 2 hours of the show, they periodically cut back to us in Los Angeles for updates as we were getting ready for Alan's procedures.
And a real eye-opener, about 1 hour from now, this man will be able to throw his glasses in the trash. He will get permanent contact lenses implanted in his eyes live.
This created a pretty powerful element of suspense. Would Alan have that aha moment when he sat up, like I said these ICL patients have in my interview?
It's like investing in HD TV, but HD vision for your eyes. Right when patients sit up from the procedure, they have this aha moment where they look around and they can see things they hadn't seen before.
A new kind of eye surgery.
Meredith and David baited the viewers like a pair of professional sport fishermen going out for the big catch. When surgeons do live eye surgery, they're much more likely to have a problem due to the extreme pressure of operating on live TV. I've witnessed this before with a number of my colleagues over the years. In my case, the stakes were really high since I was operating in front of a whole country. In the end, everything on the show went smoothly. When my staff and I watched the show air later that morning, I was amazed how effortless the whole procedure looked on TV.
Well, the first thing I'm doing to do is going to the California DMV and saying, aha.
It looked like someone just showed up at our office with a handy cam, hit the record button, and there we went. To the audience, everything looked so simple and effortless, so turnkey, if you will. In reality, things couldn't have been more different. It was a highly coordinated event and a moving target at the same time. When I explained to people about the contrast of on-camera versus off-camera, they were fascinated. They'd say, are you serious? Really? No way. Those were the typical responses. That's the reason I decided to tell you this story. Unless you've been involved with broadcast news, which I assume isn't many of you, I think you'll be truly surprised at what I'm going to show you. For the first time ever, I'm pulling the curtain back and letting you inside the phenomenon. This is the skinny behind NBC's Today Show live Vizian ICL surgery segment. My day started at 2:15 that morning. Yep, that's really my alarm clock. Well, actually, it's my wife Selena's clock. I gave it to her 15 years ago after we first got married. I adopted it back to my side of the bed a few years ago. The reason I had to get up so early was that the Today Show goes live from New York for the East Coast at 7 a.m. Well, that's 4 a.m. in Los Angeles. So we had to be all set to go at 4 in my procedure room. Being a little paranoid about sleeping through the alarm clock, I had backup. Marie in my office called me at 2:31 to be sure I got up. Now I was officially awake, but already running behind schedule.
Hello? Yeah? Hi. I'm up. Yep. Yep, I'm just ready to walk out the door. Okay, I'll see you soon.
I'll spare you these shower details. You can't be too prepared for the big close-up. I was afraid to veer one iota from my usual routine, including breakfast. I always have steel-cut oatmeal with cold water, fruit, and cinnamon. I wasn't about to change that, especially on this morning. You can say I'm a little superstitious. I went out to my daily driver. It's an old 2000 Saab. Driving an 8-year-old car probably comes as a surprise to many of you, especially to those who know I like restoring classic muscle cars. The 1971 Dodge Charger, that's my favorite. Oh yeah, I really use the turning signal at 3:15 in the morning. What can I say? It's a habit. I'll tell you, the only good thing about driving to work this early in the morning is the traffic. Or essentially, lack thereof. Technically, there was traffic. It was me. It sure would be nice if it was always like this in LA. Oh, come on, let me dream a little. When I arrived at the office at 3:30 in the morning, I hardly recognized the place. It looked like a twister had been through it, or more accurately, was still in it.
How are you?
Yeah.
Still making a mess, though.
There seemed to be miles and miles of cable everywhere. This is David. He was a sound engineer. And I hold him personally responsible for all these cables. I think he just loved running them all over the place. Every time I saw him, he was uncoiling another roll of it. Except when he was on his walkie-talkie. That was his chance to catch his breath, I suppose. That's Bill and Carlos. They were the camera operators. They set up these two huge tripods with oversized cameras. They futzed a lot over the cameras. I mean a lot. They were talking to the New York producers, after which more futzing ensued. I was starting to wonder how much someone can futz over a camera. And remember, there were two of them. And here is... Well, actually, I really don't know who this guy was, nor do I know what he was doing exactly. He must have been doing something to help get things ready, but don't ask me what. Who put it all together? It was Sandy, the on-site producer. She had a cell phone attached to her ear the whole time, except when she came up for air to say something either to Bill, Carlos, David, or this guy, at which point there was a futzing frenzy that lasted for about a minute or so, after which the activity level died back down to baseline futzing levels. On the surgical side, there was John. He's my surgical assistant extraordinaire. He got all the surgical supplies ready that we use for the ICL procedure. He directly assisted me during surgery. This is Marie. She was my right hand, almost literally. You can tell no one messes with Marie. She wrote up the schedule of events for the shoot and worked with Sandy on the sequencing. She directed us all into our positions during the shoots. Nothing was accidental that occurred on camera. It was all deliberate. Well, except for this one thing, but we'll get to that later. And there was me too. What was the deal with all those cables? Well, they ran from all the equipment, across the office, down 9 flights of stairs to the street, into the NBC satellite van that beamed the signal to a satellite which was up there orbiting the Earth that beamed us back down to the NBC studios in New York City for broadcast. For most people, speaking in front of an audience is their number one fear. That ranks even higher than fear of dying, which comes in at a mere number 2. So with speaking in front of people being so scary, how did I find myself agreeing to both speak and operate live in front of a country? From a young age, I developed a certain comfort level of being in front of the camera. It probably started back when I was in high school, when my friends and I made a feature-length student film. It was a parody of a certain superhero. We couldn't get the Batmobile, so we settled for a rental police car. Yep, that's really me in tights. We wrote the story that Batman accidentally crashes the police car, and he and Robin find another black and white car. That's my mom's 1958 Nash Metropolitan. We had to be resourceful. By the way, I still have it.
Robin, I am a billionaire. In the Batmobile... I'll put another one on order in a week or so.
Later, when I was in college at UCLA in the 1980s, I began performing live. My friends and I entered a lip-sync contest that was sponsored by MTV. We did Baba O'Reilly by The Who. I played Pete Townsend on guitar. Some might say, too well. For the record, by the way, smashing guitars was his signature move. I really don't have anger management issues. Also in college, I was on the speech and debate team. There I learned how to think on my feet, and I became comfortable answering questions in front of an audience. That's my partner, Ari Galper. We were virtually glued at the hip, and to this day, he's still one of my best friends. Ari went on to develop successful training programs for professionals, and you kind of know how things turned out for me. After I became an ophthalmologist, I began doing news interviews. Here I needed to take complex medical information and boil it down to explanations that were easy for viewers to understand.
In fact, since the 1950s, so it caused irregular amounts.
All this helped me be comfortable in front of the camera, answering questions too.
Use the laser to smooth out the irregularities in the surface.
Over the years, I'd done quite a number of news pieces. I'd done live interviews on TV, done surgery for pre-recorded news segments that got edited back at the studio and aired later that night. I'd even done live surgery for local TV in LA, but I'd never done anything like today's show magnitude. Operating live in front of a whole country was an entirely different circumstance. It's like you're suddenly cut and pasted from playing baseball in junior high school into another place. And as you look around, you realize you're standing in front of home plate at the World Series, where it's bottom of the ninth inning. You've got a bat in your hand, and oh, by the way, bases are loaded. Was I a little nervous to operate live in front of millions of people watching at home across the United States? Of course. Anyone with a pulse would be. I think the only one who wasn't nervous was Alan, the patient.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hey, Alan, are you ready?
Ready to rock and roll.
The producers wanted preparation shots during the 2 hours leading up to the lens insertion and Alan's big aha moment. We had a schedule for these cut-ins. Actually, the schedule wasn't just for me, but for all of us. The only problem was that the schedule was about as stable as oil floating on top of water. To say the process was flexible would be a slight understatement. That's the nature of live TV. I was ready after being outfitted with an earpiece that allowed me to hear Meredith and David's questions. I also had a tiny microphone so they could hear my answers. I was all set. They were going to a commercial, so I had a little breathing room. I guess the message that they were coming back to us live at the end of the commercial didn't quite get through. During the commercial break, my nose suddenly got this terrible way never happens. The producers then came back to us live for a teaser shot, but we didn't know it. I asked Maria to rub my nose, and I really leaned into it. Ooh, that felt good. John looked at Sandy, the producer, whose eyes grew bigger than saucers. Millions of people were watching Marie itch my nose. Great. Studies have shown that when someone gets nervous, the nose gets itchy. So you see, I really was a little nervous.
Fingers crossed.
Even though I was getting ready to do surgery, I knew Meredith would ask me questions. That's the nature of this gig.
So can you explain step by step what you were doing to Alan?
In the movies and TV, everyone always talks about waiting for their big close-up. I knew this shoot was a pretty big deal, so I figured there'd be an opportunity for my close-up too, which I got.
There's no such thing as a surgery that doesn't have a potential risk.
But I had my hat and full face mask on. You wouldn't know it was me even if I was your brother. That was the extent of my close-up.
The reason is because we want to minimize the risk of infection, and I'm really...
I needed to start surgery on Alan's first eye, make the tiny opening for the lens insertion, and at exactly 5:24 a.m., they'd cut back to us as I started to insert the Visian ICL into Alan's eye. The new element here was that I needed to respond to Meredith's request to narrate every step of the process, putting the ICL into position. Everything went smoothly for Alan's first eye. Just perfect. Yet, we still had to do a second eye. It was now 5:31 a.m., and at 5:51 a.m., the show would be cutting back to us after Alan's second ICL was to be completed. This would be what everyone was waiting for, Alan's aha moment. So within the next 20 minutes, my staff had to prep, clean, and drape Alan's second eye. I needed to load the ICL into the cartridge, make the tiny openings, insert the ICL into Alan's second eye, tuck the lens in position, undrape Alan, sit him up, and both of us move into position right in time for Alan's big reveal. As I was operating, I started to hear something strange in my earpiece. It was Steve Carell talking. What's he doing in my ear? I realized someone forgot to turn the sound off in my earpiece. And I'm hearing Meredith interviewing Steve back in New York about his new Dr. Seuss movie and his role as the mayor of Whoville.
Any sort of disappointment. I've always been the type of person who's, a glass half full.
Or half empty. Empty.
Yeah.
Half empty, yeah.
Yeah. And also, I just don't understand those kind of sayings.
So I'm trying to ignore all this going on in my ear while operating. I couldn't believe this was happening. In the end, I managed to mentally tune out the banter, and as scheduled, we were ready for Meredith and David at 5:51.
Next, we're going to check in on the eye surgery that you've been seeing live all morning and in our last half hour and learn if our patient can see clearly without glasses. And that's the point. But first, this is Today on NBC.
You ready to go to Hawaii?
I'm so ready to go to Hawaii.
So, Alan, when it was done, what was the first thing you saw without needing contact lenses or glasses?
You know, there's a palm tree on the ceiling here, and I can see it crisply and cleanly. It was so exciting.
So you really did have that aha moment where it was immediate?
Wow. Wow and aha. Like, wow, there it is.
So it really is like
it
HD, as you said.
Now.
Yeah, oh, great. Absolutely. See them up close and personal.
After the aha interview, we went to the next room to check Alan's vision, and he was already 20/20.
Really?
He was so happy. We had to peel him off the ceiling, so to speak. Like the Visian ICL procedure, the shoot was a mini symphony. We wrapped up on time at 6 a.m. in L.A., which was 9 a.m. in New York. At 6:30 a.m., all the equipment was gone. The surgery room and the office were completely put back to proper order. You'd never know anything had just happened here. It reminded me of Dr. Seuss's Thing 1 and Thing 2, who turned the house upside down on that fateful rainy day. And then the Cat in the Hat cleaned it all up just as the parents returned home and opened the door. I went back to my office and, at my desk, took a deep breath. I was excited and relieved at the same time. I phoned Selena to ask how everything came across on TV. She answered the phone in a very sleepy voice.
Hello?
Hello?
Hi.
I said, how did it look?
How did it look?
She said, I'm still sleeping.
What do you mean you're still sleeping?
I said, oh no, you forgot to wake up. You missed the whole thing.
I'm already done.
And at that moment, I glanced at the clock, which said 6:35 a.m.
Yeah,
it was then that I realized I forgot about the time zone change.
Yeah.
It finished airing in New York, but it was just going to start in L.A. at 7 a.m. The show hadn't even begun yet. I sheepishly apologized. Even after 15 years of marriage, let me tell you, an apology still goes a long way. It's like money in the bank. Flowers? They go even further. That's a little secret for all you guys out there. It was only 6:45 a.m. at this point, and I felt like I just put in a full day. It was really a strange feeling, kind of Twilight Zone-ish. I looked over my shoulder just to check to see if Rod Serling was there. At this stage, Marie, John, and I, well, we really didn't have anything to do. Our office wouldn't be open till 9 a.m. We had plenty of time, so we did what anyone else would do, go for breakfast. We went to this place down the street. The restaurant had TVs, and all three of us had this surreal experience. As we started our tea and coffee, the Today Show came on at 7 a.m. and opened with the teaser about the upcoming Visian ICL surgery. I've never had an out-of-body experience, but if I do, I imagine it would be like this. A few minutes later, I called Selena, and my heart almost melted when she said our daughters, Michaela and Jordana, were watching me on TV. What really did melt my heart was when I heard them say,
Dada! Dada! Dada!
They have this aha moment where they look around and they can see things they had.
The next day, Alan came back for his checkup. He was still aha-ing and seeing better than 20/20. Another happy Hollywood ending, but with a somewhat different path to get there in this case. In the end, I think this live surgery segment was unprecedented, not just for eye surgery, but for all of medicine. It kind of reminded me of when Evel Knievel did his first motorcycle jump on live national television. There, virtually the whole country tuned in to watch because of the buildup fueled by the commentators. Will it be a successful jump? Will he land safely? In retrospect, I think this live eye surgery on national TV had those same elements that captured a country's interest, but 30 years later, and in medicine. Will it be a successful surgery? Will Alan have his aha moment everyone's been waiting for? I really need to send a special thanks to Marie and John. You're the best. Thank you, Sandy. And especially thank you, Alan. Without you, this all wouldn't have been possible. Well, that's how it all went down. Now you know the skinny of what went on behind the lens. That's it for me. I'm out of here.
Woo! 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 Woo!
So, Joe, you just got finished watching the documentary. What did you think?
Well, I saw the original, but this was very, very informative. And I've been to some of his seminars, even when he was at UCLA. But I never had the procedure done, but I think finally I'm going to do it.
So this made you want to have the procedure?
Yes, yes, because like I said, I saw the original, but this was even more informative.
Deborah, tell us what you thought of the documentary.
I thought it was great. I thought it was really good. My husband got me up in the morning to watch it. He works for the company that produces the lens, and I had to tell him what it was like on TV, but the show was good, and this was really funny.
So Lisa, you came out to support Dr. Boxer Wachler, and you just finished watching his documentary. Tell us what you thought about it.
I thought it was really fascinating. You never see what goes on behind the scenes, so it was very interesting to kind of get a look at all that stuff that always looks so smooth that you never see. It was interesting.
So Tasia, what impressed you most about this documentary?
Brian's creativity, actually. I loved seeing how wacky and crazy he was with it, and that he didn't make it a conventional video. He really added his personality into it. And I have to say Batman was probably the highlight for me. Brian of Tights was pretty great. Smashing guitar. But, you know, other than that, I mean, I got LASIK surgery years ago. I had it, and it was one of the most amazing things I've ever done. So I really did relate to the aha moment and the fact that he was able to perform this very intricate surgery on television with such panache and humor. It's just great. But I really love how he made something that could have been very technical and stayed into something very charming and creative.
Well, that wraps up this edition of Southern California Medical Report. We just saw the documentary Behind the Lens and caught up with Dr. Brian Boxer Wachler. We learned that the Vizient ICL procedure can not only improve your vision, it truly can change your life forever. I'm your host, Rebecca James. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.